Viva Sato, viva!
Viva!
Viva the ANC, viva!
Viva!
Viva COSATU, viva!
Viva!
Viva the SACP, viva!
Viva!
Amanda!
Wait.
Amanda!
Wait.
Amanda!
Wait.
Amanda!
Wait.
Thank you very much, Comrade Nopala. Thank you very much, Chairperson of the province. Comrades, let me start by first of all greeting and acknowledging the number one member of SATU in the province of KwaZulu-Natal, our president, Comrade Mahope Maphela, who has given me an instruction to speak on behalf of the NSC this morning. You are greeted, Comrade President. Let me greet the leadership of SATU in KwaZulu-Natal under the stewardship of Comrade Phumlane Duma, the chairperson, as well as Comrade Primrose, the provincial secretary. Greet the entire Provincial Working Committee and the PSC. Allow me also to greet all councillors here present in this provincial general council. Let me greet the DGS, first DGS of the South African Communist Party, who is amongst our midst, Comrade Soli Mapaila. Let me greet our esteemed guests who are with us here. I may not mention all of them, but I know that young workers of COSATU are here. The student chapter of SATU is here. COSAS is here. There are also principals of schools invited specially to be special guests in this provincial council. They are greeted. Let's greet Comrade Tom Jafta from the NASCHIP and the entire delegates from the NASCHIP. Let's greet everybody that is here without mentioning all of them by name, but you are all greeted, comrades. And we are saying please accept our revolutionary greetings from our head office, Matthew Goniwe House in Kempton Park. We greet you on behalf of the National Executive Committee of SATU and the 260,000+ members of SATU across the length and breadth of our country. We want to buttress the message of the NSC by making a reference to one of the greatest leaders of our revolution, Comrade Lidwane, the former General Secretary of the Vietnam Communist Party, when he was writing around the issue of the organization and the cadre. We may not unpack, but we want to buttress as we deliver this message, appeal to councillors to keep the words of Lidwane in their minds. He said, or rather he says to us, I quote, "A strong organization ensures the strength of each person. And the strength of each person ensures the strength of the organization." unquote. Let me repeat it again. A strong organization ensures the strength of each person, and the strength of each person ensures the strength of the organization. Unquote. Again, I also want to pick another quote from him as well in the very same document, where he says, the sense of the organization and discipline is absolutely necessary in the revolutionary struggle, unquote. The sense of the organization, which I think most of the speakers who spoke yesterday and the message of the NEC this morning wants to emphasize, that the sense of the organization and its discipline is absolutely necessary. So that at all material times, we keep in mind that the organization is bigger than us. All we need to do is to submit ourselves to the organization. Kosatu said, we must submit ourselves to the line of the organization, because the organization creates the line, and ours is to submit ourselves to the line of the organization. And as you submit yourself to the line of the organization, you allow the line of the organization to change you to what the organization wants you to be. You can't, Masitonje Makolweni, you can't be, or rather you can't accept Jesus and remain the same. When you accept Jesus, you must allow Jesus to change you. Same thing similar to the organization. When you accept the line of the organization, allow the line of the organization to subject yourself to the line of the organization. As we greet you, we note that this PGC takes place in a very important month in terms of the South African calendar, as this is the youth month. It is a very important month in the history of the South African peoples and their struggle for emancipation. We therefore wish to celebrate the contributions of the young people who, in the midst of the heightened oppression and suppression of our people, consciously took a decision and said, enough is enough. They said, it is now or never. It all started in Soweto in June 1976, where a planned peaceful protest to oppose Afrikaans as a medium of teaching and learning in all the South African schools took place. I may not go to details, we all know, as it is now history, of what transpired in June 1976, wherein the then heavily armed apartheid regime unleashed its might against young unarmed school children who, because they were given no option but to defend themselves, responded with nothing but stones in their hands and shielding themselves with dustbin lids. These young people proved, without any doubt, two very important principles of any revolutionary epoch. The first one, they proved that social revolutions are not made by leaders, nor by isolated groups of activists, but by the vast number of our people who believe time has come for a fundamental change. It is not leaders who liberate people, nor is it groups of activists who liberate people, but it is people themselves who liberate themselves. And I think we must keep that in mind as we engage in this provincial general council. The youth of the time, not only did they organize themselves to oppose apartheid machina, but they also organized the workers and the communities to stay at home in an endeavor to collapse the economy that benefited a few at the time. The revolution, which was at a lull, was ignited once again, and the people never looked back. Hence, today, we are speaking of the South African democratic breakthrough that we enjoy today. That was the first principle that they proved. The second one was that every generation in its lifetime has a revolutionary mission that it must discover, pursue, and fulfill. Chairperson, this it is therefore in order for me, as we celebrate this historic youth month, that we also remind ourselves as councillors present here that June was also our freedom month during the liberation struggle. And you will recall, comrades, that our Freedom Day was celebrated on the 25th of June every year during our time of strike. So the month of June remains very, very important in our revolution. It is therefore in order to congratulate all of you for ensuring that the ANC wins the May national and provincial general elections. The ANC emerged victorious nationally and in 8 provinces. It was a win. The ANC won the elections, though to many of us, not a convincing win. Many of our people still did not go to the polls. About 9 million people did not show up at the polls. As a consequence of this predicament, we observed a nose drive in terms of the number of votes the ANC got. The number of votes we got is just not the reflection of the support of the ANC amongst our people. As I say this, I believe that the support for the ANC from our people is higher than what is reflected in the electoral results. Our people still have a few things that they want to see the ANC attending to. However, their patience is not without any limits. Their patience is running deep. Had it not been for you, the South African working class, COSATU-affiliated unions in particular, we would have been speaking different language today. South African workers under the leadership of COSATU took a conscious decision to defend the National Democratic Revolution by campaigning and voting for the ANC. That, I think, was it continues to be a very important decision of COSATU to say we'll continue campaigning and voting for the ANC, a decision I believe was a product of the highest class and ideological analysis informed by proper application of the corresponding Marxism-Leninism tools of analysis. The South African working class understood more than the ANC itself, because the ANC did not understand that it was supposed to win the election. But the South African working class understood better and more than the ANC itself as to why it was important for the ANC to win these elections. While the movement was entangled in factional battles, court battles because people did not make it to the list, gatekeeping and so on, you, the workers of South Africa, put all differences and challenges in abeyance and went all out to convince and confuse the electorate that the ANC remains the strategic leader of the National Democratic Revolution. You promised them that after the elections, we shall work on reconfiguring the alliance such that the alliance remains the strategic political center. That is how we actually persuaded the workers to vote for the ANC. On top of that, you reminded the electorate and the workers of the gains we have gained from the ANC-led government. The electorate listened, believed, and gave the ANC another chance to govern, particularly in Gauteng, comrade councillors. I remember most of us watching the results on TV in as far as Gauteng was concerned. I must indicate, Chairperson, that as we campaigned for the ANC, our people were very clear. Their cry was the same all over the country. People want jobs. People want service delivery. They wanted the national health insurance, a living wage. They want houses, clean drinkable water, quality and free public education, safe schools, safe and reliable public transport, safe streets, and many others. But most importantly, our people were saying they are tired of corruption. That was the cry of our people all over the country as you were campaigning for the ANC. We are raising these matters because this is the PGC and we want the PGC to reflect on these matters at the level of the commissions. We want the PGC as a policy-making body of the union to reflect on the role to be played by SATU in ensuring that come 2021, we don't experience the same difficulties in keeping the ANC in government as we did in these last general and provincial elections. We keep that in mind as we discuss it, understanding that our responsibility is to build socialism now for the future. We are, however, must say that there is a smell of hope out there with the commitment, diligence, and posture of the current president of the ANC and the Republic, Comrade Matamela Ramaphosa, whom you identify. I think we must not fail to remind you on this one that you, as SATU, you identified him as the better general to can lead our country through this revolutionary trajectory. Remember, comrades, it was yourself who stood firm and very resolute in the 2015 Special Congress of COSATU. You stood and you said, the deputy president of the ANC must be the president of the ANC and subsequently the president of the country. When you raise this call, everybody shrank underneath their tables and chairs, condemning SATU for talking of what they regarded as taboo at the time. You did not just raise it as SATU, but you also stood firm and ensured that it happens. You were prophetic yourself, you provided leadership, you provided light during times of darkness. Today there is hope in our country. But comrade councillors, never leave this hope to fade. As we smell hope in the air, comrade Chairperson, we must ask ourselves a question. But before we ask ourselves a question, Corporation called the Jefferson, let me remind the PGC of what Karl Marx teaches us as he deals with the question of economics and politics while he was still in Paris and about to leave Paris. This is what he said, I quote, "Not only must the old order be overthrown, but people adequate for the new must be created." Unquote. Not only must the old order be overthrown, but people adequate for the new must be created. Then the question, therefore, that we must ask is, do we have people ready to drive and defend our national democratic revolution in this epoch called the new dawn, or do we have people who are saying it is now our turn to eat? It's a question that we must be able to ask ourselves as we discuss and be able to respond to. Part of what the PGC must consider is to discuss, deliberate and enrich the discussion on the reconfiguration of the alliance. This PGC, part of it that it must do is to develop policies in the main as we approach our National Congress, so that we are able to ensure we don't leave this so-called new dawn to fade, but we take charge of it. Is what do we mean by reconfiguration of the alliance? I think we must debate, comrades, because to me it has not been very clear as to what we mean by the reconfiguration of the alliance. Remember, this definition will not come from leaders. Leaders don't liberate people. It will come from the vast majority of our people. So this is the opportunity for us to actually discuss what exactly did we mean when we promised our people that we'll reconfigure the alliance. We can't leave this discussion up until the next general elections or the local government election. And I must caution the PGC that the discussions on the reconfiguration of the alliance is not, and it will never be, an easy debate, and we must not expect it to be such. This debate will require a very strong and united Cosatu, consciously vanguarded by the South African Communist Party. Since the working class itself lacks cohesiveness and singleness of purpose to perform its historic mission. The working class itself, not that I'm saying COSATU is the working class, COSATU is the fraction of the working class, but for us, as we engage in this discussion of the reconfiguration of the alliance, will at all material time, comrade Soli, require vanguardism, or to be vanguarded by the South African Communist Party, the South African Communist Party. Because as the class, we lack cohesiveness and singleness of purpose. Now, for us to be able to engage on these matters, we therefore need a focused and homogeneous organization, ideologically so, which in this instance is the South African Communist Party, to lead us in this discussion. The PGC therefore must debate on how to build strong, united COSATU affiliates, SATU included. How to ensure that our SATU remains united and strong for us to be able to carry out our historic mission. How do we build a strong and hegemonic COSATU? COSATU yesterday said, COSATU remains the only voice of reason. If that is true, how then do we ensure that we continue and we remain hegemonic as COSATU? I will then, at a later stage, share with the PGC my understanding of hegemony. Now, the contradictions that will emerge during the debate should not be construed with disunity or factionalism. Remember, councillors, contradictions are necessary for the development of society. our organizations in line with the Lord, for the development of society and our organization in line with the laws of motion and the laws of development. May I remind the PGC that dialectics is the study of contradictions within the very essence of things, and the development is in the struggle of the opposites. Therefore, unity and struggle of the opposite is necessary for the qualitative development of qualitative change that is brought about by the struggle of the opposite. Which means that when we engage at the level of how then to reconfigure the alliance, we must appreciate and expect that there will be contradictions, and very, very sharp contradictions. And contradictions must not be construed as disunity nor as factionalism, but contradictions are necessary for the development of society. Because for society to develop, there must be contradictions. We must not be scared nor frown on opposing views. What becomes important is how do we engage each other and ensure that we find each other so that we are able to carry on with our strategic and historical mission. So contradictions are necessary, and let's embrace them. Therefore, to the extent that contradictions in our discourse are not antagonistic, we must not frown at them as they present themselves as the motive force for qualitative change, which lies in the contradictions contained within all processes of nature and society. With such contradictions properly managed, our hegemony as Cosatu in this debate remains sacrosanct. As I said, that I will share with the PGC my understanding. In fact, it's not my understanding, because it's not my original thought. It comes from Gramsci. He defines hegemony as follows, I quote, "Hegemony is a relation not of domination by means of force, but of consent by means of political and ideological leadership," unquote. Cosatu by herself may not be capable, given the nature of unions, may not be capable to provide a proper political and leadership and ideological leadership without being vanguarded by the Communist Party. That is why when we say as Cosatu in this debate, so that we ensure that we remain the voice of reason, as Cosatu indicated yesterday, we will require and we must subject ourselves to be led by the Communist Party in as far as this is concerned. The Cosatu Pega Ashiati Abanga. The student chapter must be used in order to induct young teachers joining the profession, in order to understand the dynamics of the profession itself. They must understand the field and the profession itself. How then the union come up with a program to ensure that these young people seamlessly are then absorbed in the teaching fraternity. Statistics indicate that from 20, in the last 5 years, about 31% of young teachers are exiting the system because of frustrations that they encounter in joining the system. What programs are there that we must develop as union to ensure that at the level of the profession, young people are actually assisted to seamlessly form part of the profession and be absorbed into the profession? But at the very same time, how then to ensure that those joining the union are properly inducted on the culture practices of the organization itself. Because they will inherit this organization in the future. Hence, when we talk about culture, practice, and traditions, we are very aware that such is neither static, because it continuously changes, or it is in a constant state, in a constant form of development. We understand multicultural traditions and practices are not static, comrades. They change. As society change, also culture practices also change as the society develops. But it does not mean when you join the organization, you must rush on wanting to change the culture, the traditions, and the practices of the organization. Allow yourself to be absorbed to the traditions, the culture, as well as the practices of the organization. Because that forms what we call the line of the organization. To gain young and fresh forces is always needed to strengthen the revolutionary struggle of the proletariat. Any weaknesses in gaining young forces will be a vital danger. It is not justified to worry a lot and hesitate in the face of the lack of education and experience of young people. But as far as young are concerned, a more patient and tolerant approach must be taken for the young to correct their mistakes if ever they commit any. We must be more tolerant for the mistakes of the young revolutionaries. Changes must be given to them in order to let them correct their mistakes in the course of the struggle. They must be helped and be assisted moving forward. It is a fundamental task to educate youth, especially of the working class, in the culture and traditions of internationalist communist struggle of the revolutionary proletariat and equip them with class consciousness. That is the responsibility that the PGC must actually be able to look at moving forward. Let me also touch now on other issues that the PGC must deliberate on as I sit down. Number one, I think Satu must congratulate herself, because we now have our cooperative bank as an organization. In the last 3 weeks or so, we received a license from the treasurer that we can operate our own bank called SACO or SACO Cooperative Bank. I think SACO indeed must actually applaud this giant leap. If you are talking about tinkering with the economy or trying to change the structure of the economy, these are steps of building socialism now for the future. We want to encourage members of SATU to join the bank. The bank is there at the back. They have a gazebo there. Let's join the bank. The difference between this bank and other commercial banks is that this bank is owned by members. It is not owned by shareholders, which means that if there is a surplus, that which is called profit in the business corridors, we call it surplus. The surplus is shared among members of the bank. The surplus is not shared amongst shareholders. So when you decide to bank with our cooperative bank, you join. As you join, you become a member, which means that as a member, you own, inverted commas, shares. We don't have shares, but you become a member, which therefore means you have a say in the running of the bank. Board members of the bank are elected by members. They are not appointed by shareholders and what they do. Number two, the benefit is that when you go, when you need to buy money, normally when you need to buy money, you go to FNB, you go to ABSA, whether you need to buy money to buy a house or to buy a car or to do whatever. Isn't it that when you go to apply for a loan, you are buying money? They will say, we will give you money if you qualify, but for you to pay our money back, we will charge you prime rate plus something. Maybe they will charge you prime rate plus 3%, prime rate plus 5%. In some instances, they will charge you prime rate plus 9%, which is almost double. But with our co-op bank, we are saying, if workers want to buy money because it's their money, it must be prime rate minus. In fact, we are saying when you go and apply for a loan in this bank, you must pay at least a maximum of 4% interest rate. So without taking much of the time, it's part of saying, let's tinker with the current economic structure. Let's join our own bank. Let's bank with our own bank. Let's build our bank so that in future, you will not need to go to FNB for a housing loan, but to go to your own bank and apply for a housing loan that will have a shorter payment period compared to the 20 years and 30 years that we are currently experiencing. That's one part that I wanted to quickly move to in. Secondly, is what was explained by GEPF yesterday here. In fact, COSATU, as well as the chairperson of the province, did give a picture of what is happening globally in terms of the rise of ultra-right populist led by Trump in USA. And the rise of the right-wing populist is also affecting the entire globe, as it was explained yesterday, led by USA. And part of it, that as workers we must be concerned about, is the attack on collective bargaining. For instance, comrades, in Africa, it is only South Africa who has collective bargaining processes. The rest of Africa, there is no collective bargaining. Most of the countries in Africa, they have what is called, in our own space, they have what is called teaching service commissions. The teaching service commissions will decide that from this year to this year, a period of 5 years or 10 years, there will be no increment for teachers. They decide. No collective bargaining, unions are not allowed to come closer when that decision is taken. And if you try to rise against it, to raise any protest or whatever view against that, they deal with you decisively. Leaders of union disappear in some of the African countries. So collective bargaining is under attack to say they want a free labor market, and part of what they must do is to deal with collective bargaining. Hence, we must not be excited by some of the pronouncements made by some of our leaders. I don't want to say made by some of the neoliberal champions in our government. I don't want to say that. That is why they will wake up in the morning and tell you that the public service is bloated, and therefore we are going to allow workers to retire at 55 if they want to retire at 55. And they disguise that by saying they want to create employment opportunities for young people. That is a correct, rather that is a direct, not a correct, a direct attack on collective bargaining. You can't go and make announcements about things that affect workers, without going to collective bargaining. As a result, as a union, we are not advising our members to take these packages. We are advising our members not to retire at 55. Up until they respect collective bargaining, they come and sit down with us so that we discuss and agree on how we are going to move forward. Because this could be retrenchment in disguise. 30,000 public service workers may retire through this scheme, only to find that only 10,000 are hired to replace. All 20,000 posts are frozen. And if that happens, it will simply mean it's retrenchment in its best. So we are saying, in as much as GEPF was here to explain that you will not be penalized and what have you and what have you, but we are not encouraging our members to actually take those, because it undermines our own government moving forward, our own collective bargaining moving forward. The PGC must deal with issues of early childhood development, deal with issues of grade R. Our union had a meeting with the national task team dealing with matters of ECD and grade R to say how then do we assist this sector. Remember, grade R and ECD are now moving under basic education. It must be yourself as councillors who must deliberate in commissions to say how then do we ensure this process takes place seamlessly, and how do we ensure that these workers are not exploited, how do we ensure standardization and so forth and so forth. What policy are ECD and grade R practitioners employed under? Which law, which legislation, what is the contract, what is the details of their contracts moving forward? As teachers, we know that our contract is the Employment of Educators Act. But what about ECD and grade R? This is an opportunity for the PGC to deal with those matters moving forward. Young workers spoke about the development of indigenous languages. Let the PGC deal with these matters. And I'm also tempted not to go through what, let me do it quickly. Curriculum transformation, I think, is very important. There should be no disagreement that the curriculum we have in our school is not fit for purpose. It is the curriculum that is obsessed with testing and shaming. If we are to have dignity of our teaching profession, as well as our teaching professionals, and ensure that they are respected and protected, we must break away from this neoliberal education in our schools. The curriculum based on excessive assessment and accountability, which is more the ticking of the box based kind of a curriculum, is educational and psychologically damaging to our children and cannot change the behaviors, hence so much violence in our society. The curriculum in our school, as it stands now, was construed to instill Western ideas and values of subjugating the colonized. The dignity of the colonized was undermined to an extent that their identity, land, culture, knowledge were destroyed. The upliftment of the Western epistemology at the expense of the African indigenous knowledge has to be reversed by decolonizing the curriculum in our schools and the books that we are using in our schools. We continue to use books, for example, written by Pearson. And it's something that we must take very serious as teachers. I'm happy, Chairperson, that we have our own people who are now writing books And that is the only way we can be able to decolonize the content in our classrooms. Therefore, we submit that the incremental implementation of the African languages denies the children of South Africa the opportunity to build unity and social cohesion, as there is no investment in supporting schools to implement our indigenous languages. There is no investment in the teachers to acquire African languages at the highest level, including a drive to have written books, textbooks, and all the commerce and science subjects in the African languages. They say books are not developed to be in African languages. Your science, your life sciences, your commerce, and what have you, are not developed. Language, or rather indigenous languages, are not developed to can be able to write books in our own languages. But very interesting, the Bible has been translated in all languages. Now, why is it problematic for books to be translated in all languages? The values in education can best be taught and appreciated if indigenous languages are uplifted. We are calling for a curriculum that is based on research, evidence, and experience developed by teachers and educationists. Teachers must be given their own professional capital. You must not only be the implementers of the curriculum, but you must be the developers of the curriculum. That is what a teacher should be. That is why for me it's very disappointing and discouraging when you hear a teacher saying we can't start teaching because we are still waiting for lesson plans. You as a teacher, you allow somebody else to develop a lesson plan for you. That is taking away your professional capital as a teacher. As a teacher, you need to develop your own lesson plan because you understand the dynamics of the children you are teaching. To restore the dignity of the teaching profession, we are calling for a curriculum that will emphasize in-depth understanding, which will form a sound basis for the future learning. To this end, we advocate for decolonizing the curriculum, teaching methodologies, as well as the learning material. Amilcar Cabral, at some point, also warned us when he was dealing with the Portuguese colonial domination in some parts of Africa. He says, I quote, all Portuguese education disparages the African, his culture and civilization. African languages are forbidden in schools. The white man is always presented as superior being and the African as an inferior being. The colonial conquerors are shown as saints and heroes. As soon as an African child enters elementary schools, they develop an inferiority complex. They learn to fear the white man and to feel ashamed of being African. African geography, history, and culture are either ignored or distorted, and children are forced to study Portuguese geography, history, as well as culture, unquote. That is what Amilcar Cabral said some time ago. And also, 2030 vision of SATU is also addressing this moving forward. Comrade Chairperson and councillors, I think the PGC should be cognizant of the fact that teaching profession is growing. Younger, I think we have covered that. Moving forward, the PGC must also consider the new phenomenon on the escalating attacks on teachers by learners, communities, as well as school children killing one another in schools. I think that's the phenomenon that must not escape the PGC. We must discuss this. This is a phenomenon that requires PGC to define. It requires PGC to explain. It also requires PGC to prescribe a sustainable panacea. If indeed education is a societal matter, it therefore requires mobilization of everyone and every resource to ensure that teachers are safe, the environment in which they practice is professionally safe and protected. When we talk of violence against teachers, against the support personnel in schools, against students, We're dealing with failures of our own communities and those in authority to provide security in our schools. Education is a potent tool for any developing nation and to build a developmental state. Therefore, an attack on teachers should be treated as treason, and the maximum sentence should be meted against any person who attacks a teacher. Another phenomenon that the PGC cannot miss the opportunity to discuss are the effects of the Industrial Revolution. I don't know, I may not go into details as far as that is concerned about the Industrial Revolution, but I think the PGC must then be able to engage on how we can use technology. I prefer saying so, rather talking about the fourth Industrial Revolution, but how can we use technology to enhance our teaching at the level of our schools, and how do we use technology to ensure that curriculum becomes relevant in our society. Comrade Chair, as I sit down, I wish to explain or to emphasize the point of unity, cohesion of the union. Our union is growing, comrades. Our union remains united and strong. Our union remains focused and determined to fight the betterment of her members. This makes our union an envy of many, but also an enemy to many. Our detractors within our country and international remain hell-bent to destroy our own unions, and particularly our own union circle. You know the attack by IMF and what have you. I may not go to details as far as that is concerned. The attack to our union is coming from all directions. Given all these attacks, unity remains sacrosanct. Unity remains the only weapon we can use to defend our mighty union. Unity is a means of our struggling as we move forward, Comrade Chairperson. May I remind councillors that the struggle is a normal condition for all living creatures in the world. All are in struggling, all struggling. Unity and struggle are dialectically linked. Put together, unity and struggle mean that for the struggle, unity is necessary, but also to have unity is necessary to struggle. So we want to emphasize the point of unity, that is an organization, in order to be able to deal with challenges facing us in our space in education, and also as part of the working class, to assist in terms of the realization of our historic mission as a class, we must ensure that we remain united at all material times. And unity must not be unity of convenience, but it must be unity of purpose. With those few words, we want to wish the PGC of KwaZulu-Natal fruitful deliberations as well as discussions, and wish them that they take resolutions that are going to take our union forward. Damanda.